Let's continue, though. You can bring up whatever's on your mind. Let's go to Greg, listening in Washington, D.C. You're on Free Talk Live. Hey, Greg.
Hey.
Hey, what's on your mind tonight?
Hey, so I just wanted to call because I listened to Colleen, the former Inner Circle member of Freedomain Radio, who called into one of the Liberty Radio Network podcasts last night.
Yes.
I'm not sure which one, but she was an Inner Circle member.
You're referring to the Freedom Fiends with Michael W. Dean, which airs from 1 to 3 a.m. on LRN.FM. I heard a good portion of that interview as well. It was pretty fascinating. You're referring to Stefan Molyneux, who is a kind of an internet philosopher. He's built quite a following for himself, and there are allegations about
him. And
he's
huge. I mean, you got to look at his numbers. He was like number one on iTunes. Somebody said, like, tens of millions of views on his face. On
was
his
he number one on iTunes?
He's the most popular philosophy.
You mean in like
podcast?
You mean like in a philosophy category?
I saw number one on.
I can't imagine Stefan Molyneux is going to be beating Adam Carolla. I don't believe that for a moment.
He's not.
But nonetheless, Joe Rogan, I don't think he's going to beat him either.
It is the most popular philosophy show in the world, is what he markets it as.
I don't think he's going to beat
Alex Jones.
How many philosophy
shows are there? But
yeah, I don't think he's going to beat Alex Jones. So no,
been on there a lot too.
Doesn't matter, Mark. I'm talking about whether he could beat them on iTunes. I don't think that, you know, he can hold a candle to them. We sure as hell can. We've got 160 radio stations. So anyway, Stefan, yeah, you're right there. I'm just kind of explaining for new listeners, Greg, who Stefan Molyneux is. So anyway, he hosts this podcast. It's become very popular. And they're, you know, when you become popular, people are going to go after you. And in this case, they've got some legitimate reasons, I think, to go after him, including the allegations that his business manager apparently has and Stefan confirmed this, so I guess they're not really allegations, but that his business manager used copyright law to attack a critical YouTube channel, somebody who was putting up critical videos. Anyway, they had one of these, one of his supporters or former supporters from the what's called the Inner Circle, apparently, of a very close-knit group of very, you know, devoted Stefan Molyneux supporters. This lady is a defector, and that's the interview you were referring to listening to. Go ahead, Greg.
Yeah, yeah. So I just wanted to I too was part of that inner circle, about 10 or 12 people. There was actually a private message board even above the Philosopher King board that they talked about last night called the Friends of FDR. It's at, I don't know, 12, 15 maybe people.
Said she was part of, where there was like maybe 10 or so people.
Exactly, something like that. And I actually was very close friends with Colleen. She, you know, visited me for Christmas one year, and I just I want to corroborate everything she said. She was spot on some of even the really bold things that she said.
Give us a breakdown, because obviously not everybody listened to that interview on Freedom Fiends, which it was a fascinating interview. So go ahead with what do you want people to know?
Well, I mean, one of the things that seems to get an audible jaw drop on the podcast was that Steph thought that it was not possible to be a good parent until Freedomain Radio came along, and that was a pretty accepted theme among FDR. And there was even
that he basically what you're saying is that he has brought the message of good parenting finally to the earth.
Something like that, you know. A very sort of almost messianic perspective, and you could hear the jaws drop on that podcast or
by the way, Freedom Fiends is a live radio program that is added to a podcast later on.
Yep. And let me ask you about this. Is there some claim like the Liberty Movement would be set back 2,500 years if it wasn't
for Stefan Molyneux?
For Stefan. What is the claim behind that? Because I mean, that's a bold claim.
I think my interpretation of that is that he's so important to the movement that we'd be in trouble without him. But what is your interpretation, Greg? And have you heard that statement?
I didn't hear that statement directly.
Thank goodness.
Honestly, well, because I stopped listening a few years ago. I mean, honestly, this wasn't actually something that I was prepared to talk about publicly, but I feel so compelled to do so after what's been going on over the past week and what, you know, listening to Colleen open up. But I hope this isn't too dark for your podcast, but I had a suicide attempt while I was in Freedomain Radio, and Steph, you know, there was what happened. He called me after he heard about that attempt, and he asked me how many years do you think that you would have set the freedom movement behind had you completed your suicide attempt?
Okay.
And I think that the implied message there being Freedomain Radio, and like I would have set the movement back because of, you know, the negative publicity that would have occurred, the cult accusations that would have occurred, and Freedomain Radio is the last bastion of hope for the liberty movement.
Let me try to stand up for Stefan here. Okay, so I think if the words that he asked you were, how many years do you think your suicide would have set the liberty movement back? Right. So if you're in Stefan's inner circle, I'm gonna go ahead and assume that you understand the things that he's talking about. Right. You understand what he's talking about. Right.
Sure.
That's probably how you get into the inner circle. And so if you're somebody who understands Stefan Molyneux, I'd say that you're pretty important to the liberty movement. Okay. And because I do think that, look, Stefan's kind of an egomaniac. Okay. But he is talking about some really, really important stuff.
And important.
Well, one of the nice things.
And he's doing a lot of great stuff.
And no doubt.
And if you understand his stuff, then you not being here is a detriment to the liberty movement. You know, FDR be damned, you know.
That's a fine point, but I think that what you're suggesting, maybe, Greg, that Stefan Molyneux was getting at with that point is that, oh well, it's all about the movement. You know, you weren't thinking about the movement.
Well, no, he explicitly said afterwards what, you know, and this is as close to a direct quote as I can get 5 years later. What sorts of news stories would have come out after that?
Probably none. So, I mean, it's just a suicide.
Well, That's the thing that I think about later. I mean, I'm obviously far removed from it. I've reconnected with my family since then, but it's just things like that that, you know, I think when I hear the stuff about the 2,500 years, you know, the Liberty Movement being set back, if Steph weren't around, I think back to things like that. And there are other things when Colleen was talking about, you know, there are no good parents before Steph. That was definitely an accepted thing at Freedomain Radio. That was something that people just accepted as the truth. That, and it was, as I was saying earlier, it was a syllogistic argument that was, Steph has figured out UPB, University of Preferable Behavior, morality.
What is, whoa. And, UPB, and, is this jargon?
Universally Preferable Behavior.
It is jargon.
Is that specific to Stefan Molyneux?
He put forward the concept of universally preferable behavior.
Rather than moral behavior.
Right.
Right. Well, not wanting to devolve into the conversation that you and I have on a pretty regular basis, like what is moral and what is truth. He has come up with terminology to sidestep that kind of nonsense, like what color is the sky. And he uses the term universally preferable behavior, or UPB.
He also has the term defoo, which stands for remove oneself from their family of origin. Again, this is more jargon, and whenever you hear jargon, that's usually a red flag that you may be dealing with a cult.
Yes, and so there was, I remember articles and I remember podcasts saying that because parents didn't have UPB, his universal preferable behavior, which is basically Papa's, you know, argumentation ethics, you know, in a different, you know, coat of paint, right? But because the world didn't have this, parents who taught morality to their children were lying to their children about their core knowledge of knowing morality. Therefore, pretty much all parents before Steph were liars. Therefore, all parents, there was an implicit argument that all parents are bad. I know that there are no, you know, direct quotes of Steph saying all parents are bad, but there was definitely a sort of implicit syllogism that.
Now, wasn't there? There was a statement that Colleen, the lady that was on Freedom Fiends last night, made about how inside the inner circle that was more clear.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. It was absolutely made clear.
Like that, he may not say in real life that all parents are bad. He might not come right out and say that, but that was pretty clear if you were in the inner circle.
Yeah,
stand absolutely. By, Greg. I'd like to come back with more here. I want to find out how you got out of it, and because you said you were involved with it a few years ago, so hopefully he's got time to stick through the news, as you will as well. 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number here. You can take control. It's Free Talk Live. The This is Free Talk Live. You can bring up anything that you want toll free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. You know, I was actually up late, as I tend to be. You know, we do a night show, so I was up late listening to the Freedom Fiends last night, and I heard them interviewing a lady. I didn't catch her name until actually Greg called in tonight to tell us what it was. Colleen was on their show last night, and it was Michael Dean as well as, Dobby Barker, I think, was on as well. And they were talking with this lady who was formerly involved with the Stefan Molyneux group of fanatics.
Why use that terminology?
Some would call them cultists, and
fans?
Fan, that's what fan's short for, you know.
Sort of.
Fan is short for fanatic. Anyway.
I'm a Stefan Molyneux fan, and I wouldn't say that I'm a fanatic.
Okay. I think he does great videos.
Well, anyway, fan is short for fanatic, so that's something I wanted to mention here before we bring Greg back on the line, because Greg is also saying that he was involved with the Inner Circle, which is a very small group of about 10 to 15 supporters of Stefan Molyneux, who's this kind of internet philosopher who's made it real big and has hit on lots of podcasts. He's been on Alex Jones, and he's been on Joe Rogan, and he's gotten great exposure for the ideas of liberty. And that's something you were saying, Chris, during the news break, was that you feel like, and Chris Cantwell is here with Ian and Mark, but you feel like he's done a lot for the ideas of freedom. And there's no doubt about it. I mean, we've had Stefan on our show multiple times. He's been on as a guest co-host in the past, live from the Porcupine Freedom Festival.
I think he's easily one of the most important people in this movement. There's no question about it in my mind.
He's a friendly guy. He's a good communicator of the ideas of freedom. But man, he's really stepped in it recently. I mean, with this whole use of copyright to take down a channel that's critical of him, that's, to me, one of the biggest oversteps, and it's something that should be apologized for, and like they've been suggesting on Freedom Fiends, he should try to make right to the owner of that channels that, I think it's actually more than one channel, that that were taken off of YouTube as a result of copyright claims by a guy who supposedly is against intellectual property. So that should be rectified.
That's a pretty nasty contradiction, and I don't agree with him doing that. Let me play devil's advocate here and say that, like, you're on YouTube and you're agreeing to terms of service. I mean, this is what people always tell me when I get banned from Facebook. Nobody seems to care. I'm banned from Facebook right now, and I didn't even do anything. I'm literally banned for being made an admin of a group that I never even posted in. Okay.
Not guilty.
But the thing is, like, you know, look, Google's a private company, and they set their own terms of service, and one of the terms that they set is don't copy the other guy's stuff. And if you go and you copy the other guy's stuff, then, you know, someone's going to bring the hammer down on you.
But it wasn't about even copyright. They used copyright as their lever against the channels that they didn't like because it was critical.
And when they were being critical, they were probably using clips from his stuff, and it's his own copyrighted material. And
that sounds like fair use to me.
It's fair. It's fair use because it's critique.
When you put out video and you want, you know, I'm like, how can I comment on your video without showing video?
Right.
So that sounds like fair use to me.
And even if their excuse for it wasn't about, oh, well, you know, we want to use copyright. It was, well, we used that because we wanted to protect our listeners. And apparently one of the channels was allegedly, supposedly doxing some of the listeners and putting information out there about them. But again, my position is it's not my job as a talk show host to protect my listeners. It's a lame excuse for using copyright against somebody who's critical. Look, Chris Cantwell, you know what it's like out there on the internet. People are going to critique you when you're visible, when you have a strong opinion. And, you know, you've got to be willing to handle that. I mean, to run around and issue takedown notices to everybody who criticizes you, to, you know, file a lawsuit. I'm not saying Stefan filed a lawsuit, but, you know, it's using the law to go after somebody who's critical.
When you make a takedown notice, what you're doing is you're threatening a lawsuit. Yeah. That's the reason that it's getting taken down, because they don't want to end up in court.
Right. And so anyway, that's a huge issue. But there's others. And we've got Greg back with us here in D.C. Now, Greg, you said you were on the inside or the inner circle, inner sanctum of the Stefan Molyneux group. And how did you end up leaving?
I think I fundamentally ended up leaving because Stefan made specific promises about the quality of the relationships that I would have as a result of Freedomain Radio, and those promises just didn't bear themselves out. The relationships and friendships at FDR were so ephemeral. They were you would be friends with someone for 3 months, 5 months, 6 months, a year, and then something would happen, and then either you were shut out from that friend, or they were shut out from you. And I was
How were they shut out? What's that mean?
Well,
are we talking
I mean,
about internet friends here? We're not even talking about real life, are we?
Well, the Colleen came to Christmas.
The line blurred quite a lot. I mean, okay. In fact, I moved to Philadelphia along with I was living with three other listeners, and some other people moved there. And at one point, we had like 8 or 9 people living in Philadelphia meeting up regularly. It was a the line was blurred quite a bit, and I was in on calls and meetups where we were like, you know what, we're not, you know, they're not feeling like this person's living up to their values. I feel bad about that. And that's not the way that I really thought that I was going to get, you know, happiness with my relationships. And one of my very closest friends now, I remember very specifically being on a call with Steph and three or four other Inner Circle members. And we were just going to, you know, let person X take a break from the community for a little bit. This friend still feels like a gut-wrenching pain when he thinks about this. I still talk with him. He's one of my best friends, and I feel horrible about that because it was definitely pressured to not talk with him. And after my suicide attempt that I mentioned earlier, Steph told me that I needed to take a little bit of a break from the community. So I took like a month or so. This was back in 2008. So I think fundamentally, though, it was when Steph, back when the, you know, legal, not legal, who knows, stuff with Christina was going on, he expressed some upset about me and a few other Inner Circle members not, quote, anticipating his needs about what he would need about emotional support and so on.
What was the legal stuff you were referencing there?
That was the stuff that he gave some half-truths or mistruths about on the Joe Rogan show, which was that, you know, his wife being reprimanded.
His wife, you're talking about Stefan Molyneux's wife, is apparently a licensed therapist, and there was some sort of a dust-up between her and the licensing board about her giving out advice on a podcast or something like that. And you said the allegation is that Stefan told a lie about that on Joe Rogan?
Yeah, he said that she wasn't, I don't know quite the specifics of the lie, but he minimized it. That's why I call it a half-truth, because technically, if you can see where he is telling the truth by the letter of the word, like, but the specific words, but no, he is not telling the full truth about that. She was absolutely reprimanded. One of the statements was that the DFU, which is cutting off your family of origin, is not recommended in any of the scientific literature, and she signed that agreement. And yeah, he definitely washed over that in the Joe Rogan show.
And this was recent on the Joe Rogan show. He recently appeared.
This was like a week ago, yeah.
But right. You've been out for how many years? You've been out of the fandom?
The reason I bring that up is because the legal stuff, that was going on back in 2010 or so. Okay. Mid-2000, no, 2011 maybe. And I was one of the few Inner Circle people who knew about this. And he was upset that I and a few others weren't reaching out to him, asking how he was doing. And actually, candidly, I was Skype, you know, sending him a Skype message every other day, asking how the stuff was going. And to me, going back to the friendship stuff, like, he considered me, I thought, a friend. And yet he, you know, was, you know, had these new rules about our friendship, which was, I need to anticipate his needs.
Were you sending him money?
I sent him close to $2,000.
You know, Stefan makes his money because, you know, I mean, this is what he does, right? Like, he produces videos, and he produces videos that are pretty important, I've got to say. I've seen a couple
of them. Some of them are.
Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, it's like dandelion seeds, you know, you put all this stuff out there, and then some of them, you know, land in just the right spot. And that's what he does. So, I mean, obviously, as a video producer, he has to be paid in some manner or another. We have the AMP program. We take money, but we use it.
People can donate to you through ChristopherCantwell.com.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think it's interesting.
I'm more than happy to take money.
I think it's interesting to know what, you know, people have donated and that sort of thing. I mean, you know, it shows a level of commitment. But
that's not an indicator of whether or not it's a cult. Now, Greg, I'd like you to answer. Can you hang on with us a little bit more? A few more questions.
Absolutely, I'll stay on the line. Yeah.
That's what I want to know next. Is it your view on this that this was indeed a cult that you were involved with after the fact? Looking back, hindsight being 20/20. We'll come back with more with Greg here. 855-450-FREE. Free Talk Live. This is Free Talk Live, and you can bring up anything you want here. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Still want to get back to the Galt's Gulch discussion. Plus, Chris Cantwell found an interesting story about a court decision, some disturbing court possibilities as well, about redefining what threatening is considered legally. So I'd like to talk about that. Of course, your calls come first here. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Antiwar.com is doing a fundraiser right now, and I don't know how many days are left in this thing, but they're getting close to their goal. They're over halfway to the goal, but they need to make the goal to keep the site operating and to keep the news flowing. The only real great site with anti-war opinion and editorial and news. It's a great site. It's been around for a long time, and let's keep it together. And in fact, right now there's a Bitcoin doubling, a matching fund available. Up to $10,000 worth of Bitcoin is on the table that is matchable, essentially. So if you contribute some Bitcoin over at antiwar.com, some of that Bitcoin that's on the table will go to match it. If you don't have Bitcoin, you want to do credit card or PayPal or something like that, they also have $26,000 in non-Bitcoin funds that are available for matching. So whatever it is that you give to antiwar.com, it will likely be matched. Please go there and do that if you support antiwar.com's efforts. Whether you even read the site or not, they do some great work there. So let's continue here. We've got Greg. He's in Washington, D.C., calling in about Stéphane Molyneux, which is, we don't normally talk about Stéphane Molyneux on Free Talk Live. It's not normally a topic that comes up, but within the last couple of weeks, it has come up multiple times. People are very concerned about this, and I imagine there are people out there who would like us to not be talking about this sort of thing. But as much as I appreciate what Stéphane Molyneux has done for the ideas of freedom, and he has no doubt propagated those ideas, I'm not going to run interference if somebody has something they want to reveal about their experience in being a supporter of Stéphane Molyneux and some of the things they experienced and they saw and they heard, because maybe things aren't all as they seem, and maybe there are some real legitimate concerns about how things were run and what specifically him taking down a YouTube channel which had clips that maybe he didn't want people to hear, like this one.
When I recognize that if it's not for this show and me right now, for all that I can see, people might have to wait another 2,000 years or 2,500 years for someone to come along who's willing to take this stand.
Now, I don't know. That's obviously out of context. I don't know which stand he's talking about, whether it's a stand regarding parental abuse or whether it's a stand regarding talking about the ideas of freedom.
Well, to him, these are the same things. That essentially that, from what I've gotten is that, it's all wrapped together, that government is abuse and that it all stems from people striking their children.
Greg is with us here. He was on the inside or the inner circle of Stéphane Molyneux. This is he's an internet philosopher. Stéphane's website, by the way, is freedomainradio.com. It at least deserves a plug so people can go and listen on their own, make their own decision.
And he's a powerful broadcaster.
But the critical channel on YouTube is now called True Mirror, TRUMIRROR. I'll put a link out to it on our Facebook, Google Plus, and Twitter. That's where all the videos that were taken down from the previous channel, True Sheebs, that those were re-uploaded to a different channel. So they're still there, just like with the Streisand effect. Now that Stéphane has attacked the True Sheebs channel and had it taken down, it's only, of course, popped back up and now has become more controversial, and there's now more discussion about these videos and more discussion about the channel and more attention brought to the whole controversy. So again, he would have been better off just letting it be. Just letting the channel be.
I can tell you from my own experience that the people who have tried to shut me up have done the exact opposite.
Yeah.
Yes, I've told the Free State Project board this.
So, Greg, you're back with us here. The statement that he's saying here is that people might have to wait another 2,000 years or 2,500 years for someone to come along who's willing to take this stand. I mean, what do you have to say about that as somebody who is formally involved? Do we have Greg? In Washington. Greg in D.C.
Oh, sorry.
Hey,
sorry.
We got you.
I had you on mute.
Go ahead.
There we go. No, I think it's bullshit.
Oh, you can't say that on the radio. Unfortunately, we're going to give you one a mess up.
Yeah, you're practically an interview at this point.
Right, this is basically an interview. Most of the time, we'll drop a call on that, but we're going to give you the chance to not do that again. This is on real radio stations, so keep that in mind.
Okay.
So you were saying about Stefan Molyneux's statement about people having to wait 2,000 years or 2,500 years for someone to come along who's willing to take this stand. You were saying that is BS.
Yes, and the reason I think that is that first of all, I think that he's overstating his role. I think that he did have a very good role in certain aspects, particularly talking about things like peaceful parenting and things like that. But he has a habit, I think, of not talking about the people that came before him. I think there are a couple of podcasts where he talks about the three podcasts worth reading are Rand, Nietzsche, and Aristotle. And that's obviously an exaggeration. He's obviously like on a podcast saying words into a microphone, as you, Ian, said the other night. But no, I think that there is some that takes a little bit of an ego to have that cross your mind.
Absolutely.
And then to put yourself as the fourth main philosopher in human history, and I really do think that he thinks that. As Colleen said, I was actually there in a hotel lobby when he said the comment about, he actually like put a microphone in between us. It was just the two of us. I had met there for a barbecue in Toronto, and he put a microphone in between us with the chairs, and he said, yeah, just by the way, I record every conversation I have. I even like keep it on when I go to the grocery store. Wouldn't it be cool to see like Socrates going to the grocery store? That's where, that, and I think he told that to other people, and that's sort of the ideology of where that quote came from.
Well, gotcha.
I do think that to do that job, you have to have something of an ego. And,
sure.
I guess that is what it is. Also, no one's going to promote you like you promote you. So,
well, that's true. I think the problem with doing a one-man show in a lot of cases is that the ego can go wild when there's nobody else in the room to check you when you say something stupid or something crazy
you've designed Free Talk Live never to do that. You called it Free Talk Live. It's not the Ian and Mark show. The whole idea is to not have that thing going on here on Free Talk Live. And frankly, one of the fastest ways to get off the air on Free Talk Live is to start telling the show host, specifically Ian, but it makes me uncomfortable too, that they're great and awesome and that kind of thing.
I
love what you guys do. That's fine. Right. But,
just
a whole bunch of that.
Doing what I can with a microphone. So, Greg, the question I asked you before we went to break was, looking back on this, and you said it's been a few years since you've been involved with the Stefan Molyneux Inner Circle. Were you involved in a cult?
I'm not comfortable calling it a cult. I think there were some clearly culty aspects to it. I think specifically the groupthink of getting on calls and deciding who needed to take a break from the community, the off-limits nature of certain discussions. I mean, you can go to the board right now, and I think there's still a post pinned to the top that determinism is off-limits. You can't talk about determinism on the board. Hmm. Things like that.
It sounds like Keen.
Thank you for sharing tonight. I really appreciate you calling in and sharing your experience, Greg.
You don't think Ian would talk about determinism?
We'll talk about anything here on Free Talk Live. Thanks for the call tonight.
It'll annoy me.
The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. You can call in, share your thoughts on whatever's on your mind here on Free Talk Live.